to thank Sister Angela in a very special way for that song. Today is only made possible because Jesus Christ was willing to die in our place. Amen. I just want to stop to say that I'm so happy to be able to identify with a global audience. Today there are people from all walks of life, indicating the extent of the everlasting gospel and the power of the grace of Jesus Christ to save people from everywhere. I want to welcome you in a very special way, and we do not have much time for my presentation. It's going to be extremely short, but we promise that we will cut it short in righteousness. And so at this time, what I will do, I will invite you to forget about the cares of life, forget about everything else. At this moment, I will invite you to turn your eyes upon Jesus and to look full in his wonderful face. Just allow the things of this planet to diminish and to grow dim in the light of God's glory and grace. Our great God and our Father who art in heaven, we pause at this moment to thank you and to praise you because you are God and you are worthy to be praised. Amen. Father, we thank you and we praise you for life. We thank you and we praise you for the plan of salvation. We thank you, Lord, and we praise you for this great Sabbath, for this great weekend, for the great controversy. Lord, we thank you and we praise you. And now, Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that as your word is presented, that you will make it clear and understandable to the listeners. But we also ask, Lord, that above all things, that you will lift up the name of Jesus and glorify it. May you lift his name higher than it has ever been lifted before. Lord, your people are here. And I ask now, O Father, that you will bring your truth alive, that you will bring it alive in our minds, that you will bring us conviction and conversion through thy word, because, Lord, we are living in the time of the end. Into your hands we commit this service. And, Lord, I pray now that thou will touch my brain cells, that you will bring inspiration from above. And let the truth of God be lifted up, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Allow me to just make mention of the late Gary Harrison briefly. I met Gary in 1999, And since then, we have worked together in many programs. Gary Harrison was somebody who breathed evangelism. It was the breath of his life. And so up until the time that he died, he was planning this great controversy weekend. Sad to say, he is not here with us today. But let me hasten to say, my friends, that God has got the power to work all things together for good to them that love him. Amen. God has a way of turning our tragedies into miracles. And so I believe that this great controversy weekend, which has now just started here in Northampton, I believe that through it, the Lord will ignite a fire that will engulf this planet until the coming of Jesus Christ. And so let us stand with Jesus under the bloodstained banner of Prince Emmanuel. As part of the great controversy, today I want to present to you the conflicts of the true Sabbath. I want us to know and to understand that we are locked in a great controversy. It's a controversy between God and Satan. And let me hasten to say that there is no spectator whatsoever. We all are a part of this great controversy. It's either we stand for Jesus Christ or we will stand with the devil until the time of his fall. And so I'll invite you at this time to turn your Bibles, and I hope that you have got them. Turn your Bibles with me to 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 12. Peter tells us, "Wherefore, I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, though you know them and be established in the present truth." Peter was a preacher and teacher of present truth. If ministers in this time present anything except the present truth, it will be registered in the portals of heaven as sinful neglect. Peter says, "I will not be negligent to present to you, to keep you in remembrance at all times of the present truth." Somebody says that there are many precious truths contained in the Word of God, but it is the present truth that the flock needs at this time. So what Peter is saying, my friends, is that there are many truths in the Bible, but we have got a present truth, and we must dwell on the present truth. Many truths there are in the Bible, but we must distinguish the present truth from all the other truth. So let me say, my friends, that God has a special message of truth in the time of Lot. The message was, "Up, get thee out of Sodom." In the time of Noah, God had a message, "Get in the ark and be saved." In the time of Daniel, my friends, God had a message for Israel. 70 weeks are determined upon you to put away sin and to bring about everlasting righteousness. In the time of Jesus, Jesus had a present truth. He says to his listeners, The time is now fulfilled. Repent and believe the gospel. I have seen the danger of the messengers running off from the important points of present truth to dwell upon subjects that are not calculated to unite the flock and sanctify the soul. Satan will here take every possible advantage to injure the cause. My friends, we are told that the truth for this time is carefully selected to unite God's people. But today, as we look at the church is divided. God's church has become fragmented. We hear about right wing and left wing, and we hear about liberals and conservatives. Let me say, my friends, God is not interested in liberals and conservatives. What God is looking for is a church that is united upon the grounds of present truth. Amen. And so somebody says, my friends, that our church has become an irrelevant debate in society. A church, my friends, that is arguing about a same-sex union. A church that is arguing about women's ordination. But ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, let me say here and now that what God is looking for is a church that is prepared to stand on the truth of Almighty God. A church that is prepared, my friends, to go forward as clear as the morning, to go forward as clear as the moon and as bright as the sun. God is looking for a church, my friends, that will stand up militarily under the bloodstained banner of Prince Emmanuel. And so, such subjects as the sanctuary, in connection with the 2300 days, the commandments of God, and the faith of Jesus are perfectly calculated to explain the past Advent movement and show what our present position is, establish the faith of the doubting, and give certainty to the future. So here, my friends, we have got calculated present truth. The sanctuary message, my friends, is designed to teach us righteousness by faith. The first piece of furniture when you enter into the sanctuary is the sanctuary of burnt offering. Paul tells us, my friends, in Romans chapter 12, 1 and 2, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto the Lord, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, so that you will know what is the good and perfect will of God Almighty. When this is accomplished, my friends, God will not have a debating church. What God will have is an active church under the bloodstained banner of Prince Emmanuel, a church that will listen to the voice of Jesus Christ, a church that will not stop to listen to people's suggestions. And so the 2300 days prophecy is carefully calculated and designed to teach us about the end time judgment of God. It's a piece of prophecy, my friends, that is prepared. It is designed to teach us to follow Jesus Christ by faith and to have our sins washed away so that we can stand up before the presence of a pure and holy God. The commandments of God, they are calculated as well to teach us that God has a constitution. God is not slack, my friends, that he would create a world and just leave it there in chaos. God is not like that. And so the Ten Commandments, they form the basis of God's government. The Ten Commandments are the transcript of God's character. They form the constitution of heaven. Let me say, my friends, the Ten Commandments are calculated as present truth. We must lift up God's Ten Commandments, and we must lift up the seventh-day Sabbath that is buried under the rubbles of paganism. The faith of Jesus Christ is calculated also as present truth. The faith of Jesus indicates, my friends, that we must have the mind of Jesus. When we have got the mind of Jesus, my friends, we cannot be divided. When we have got the minds of when we have got the mind of Jesus, we will see the truth of God in the light of heaven. We will see eye to eye with one another. And so, I have frequently seen were the principal subjects on which the messengers should dwell on. And so let's move on. Wherefore, I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, though ye know them and be established in the present truth. So Peter is speaking to an audience that is well established in the truth of God. But Peter knew there and he understood that we are retarded and so we need to be reminded. And Peter says, listen, I will focus on the present truth. That's what the ministers of God need to do in this day and in this time. We must focus on the present truth. Peter tells us, for we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. Here we find Peter is giving an account of his apostleship. Peter is saying, listen, we don't follow fables. We met Jesus. We knew Jesus. We were there in the mount when Jesus was transfigured. We heard the voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. But we have also a more sure word of prophecy. So what Peter is saying, even though we are eyewitnesses to Jesus, don't take our word for it, because why? We have got a sure word of prophecy, whereunto you do well that you take heed as unto a light. Let me say, friends, that the prophecies of God, they are given as light to guide us in the way of righteousness. The Bible says that thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Prophecies are given, my friends, to guide us in the light of God's righteousness. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 20, 21, despise not prophesying. Prove all things and hold fast to that which is good. Despise not prophesying, my friends. Test the word of God with the word of God. Jesus Christ himself came along and he says, when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. Whoso readeth, let him understand. So here we find Jesus, the master teacher, is pointing us to prophecy. Because why? We have got a more sure word in prophecy. So let me take you into a few prophecies, because I've got just a short period of time to get you to where I need to get you today. So Daniel chapter 7 and verse 25, it says, and he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High. And he shall think to change times and laws. Here we find that a piece of prophecy is telling us of a power that would think to change God's time and laws. Let me hasten to say, my friends, that God has given his word, and nobody should attempt in any way to change them. But here we find the word of God tells us that there is someone who would attempt to change times and laws. Only think to change times and laws. Nobody cannot change the word of God, because the things that are gone out of the mouth of God cannot be altered. So they can only think to change time and laws. And so we find that the papacy has caused a lot of confusion in this world. She has given pagan names to the months of the year. This same power, my friends, has given pagan names to the days of the week. It has changed the start of the year from springtime to winter time. It also, my friends, put in place a false start of a day, putting it at midnight when originally God tells us that it is at sunset. Not only that, but the crowning act of the papacy is changing the Sabbath of the true and living God. And so the word of God tells us that this power would attempt to change the laws of God. That's presumption, my friends, because God is God and none can stand against Almighty God. God is love, my friends, and God has got a purpose for this planet. God is love, and God is working to save humanity, and now he's calling on each and everyone to cooperate with him. Not only that, but if you look at your almanac, your calendar, for 2015, it will look something like that. Originally, my friends, God doesn't have anything like Monday and Tuesday. That Monday is really Moon's Day, and that Sunday is really Sun's Day. We don't have time to go into that. But initially, my friends, God never had Sunday and Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday. God had first day, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, sixth day, and Sabbath day. Amen. Then later on, my friends, in the Jewish economy, God had first day, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, preparation day, and Sabbath day. But gradually we find that there's a shift in things, and these things are being highlighted before our very eyes, and we don't even understand that it's a part of the great controversy. But I pray that our eyes will be open today, my friends, to see the great conflicts between truth and error on this planet. Not only that, my friends, but the word of God tells us, yea, he magnify himself even to the prince of the host, and by him the daily sacrifice was taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down. So not only did this satanic power think to change times and law, but the word of God tells us that it cast down the truth of God to the ground, and it practiced his evil schemes, and it prospered. The truth, my friends, was buried under the rubbles of paganism. And so an host was given him against the daily sacrifice by reason of transgression, and it cast down the truth to the ground, and it practiced, and it prospered. Not only did the truth of God cast down to the ground, but we find that gradually errors were emerging, eclipsing the truth of God. So while the truth was being dragged down, we noticed that things like purgatory and indulgence was introduced. Penance and mass was introduced. Prior to Mary and dead saints were introduced. Infallibility of bishops was introduced. Ordinance of so-called priests was introduced. Lent and Christ's Mass was introduced. A day starting at midnight and the Cronach, which is Sunday sacredness. Sunday sacredness, my friends, is nothing but sun worship. Paganism, my friends, has brought sun worship into Christianity. Baptize it, my friends, in the name of demonism and give it to the world today as a Sabbath. And so we find a big question emerges. What is truth? Because we must dwell on present truth. What is truth? The Word of God tells us that Jesus said unto them that I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Jesus Christ, my friends, is the living truth. But we have got the written truth as well, the spoken word of God. The word says, thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and thy law is the truth. Psalms 119, 142, and Psalms 119, 151, thou art near, O Lord, and all thy commandments are truth. So here we have established, my friends, what is truth. Jesus Christ is truth. The Ten Commandments of God, they are truth. And so Isaac Newton, the great man of science, was one of those who studied the prophecies, and he saw that the truth of God would be restored. He wrote, the many and clear prophecies concerning the things to be done at Christ's second coming are not only for predicting, but also for effecting a recovery and reestablishment of long lost truth. So, my friends, according to Isaac Newton, the prophecies, they are also designed to help with the bringing back of the truth of God that was buried under the rubbles of paganism. John Milton, the poet, he also, in addressing the British Parliament, said, truth indeed came once in the world, speaking of Jesus Christ, our divine master, and was a perfect shape, most glorious to look on. But when he ascended, and his apostles after him were laid asleep, then straight arose a wicked race of deceivers who took the virgin truth, hewn her lovely form into a thousand pieces, and scattered them to the four winds of the earth. And so we find, my friends, John Milton presenting this to Parliament, saying, from that time ever since, the sad friends of truth, such as doors appear, went up and down, gathering limb by limb, still as they could find them. We have not yet found them, lords and commons, nor ever shall do, till her master's second coming, he shall mold them into an immortal feature of loveliness and perfection. So here we find, my friends, there are those who were gathering truth. What are we doing today? Are we established in the present truth? We have those who were going from place to place, gathering the truth of God, Thank God today we don't have to go gathering truth. We are to be established in the present truth so that we can present it to the world. I'm afraid to say, my friends, that the enemy has still a march upon us, because instead of those of us who are established in the truth go publishing the truth of God, we are arguing over the things that God has given to make us a powerful church. My friends, it is time that we become united under the truth of God. And so in the dark ages, we had some people who came along and they were gathering truth. What are you doing today? Are you establishing truth? The first, my friend, is the Waldenses. They were in the valleys. They were in caves. They never had life as comfortable as us today, my friends. We live in comfortable houses with air condition when we need it and eating when we need it. We have got computers and television and iPhone and iMac and I this and I that. They only had the word of God in the valley, and it made them powerful. But the word of God tells us that through the dark ages, the Waldenses, thank God that God had a church in the wilderness, because when they emerged from the wilderness, they had the truth of the living God. So that today you and I can practice and prosper in the name of Jesus Christ. Immediately after that, we had Hus. He came along and he says that we must be obedient to the God of heaven. We must not pay homage unto any man. Jesus Christ alone shall we worship, and him only. And that's the same principle today, my friends. We must not worship any man. We must worship Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Immediately after that, Luther came along, and Luther promoted grace. Luther said, no more will I climb up the steps of Rome. So that then came Calvin, and he brought with him Christian growth. He's saying that, well, church people are not to be stagnated. We cannot remain in church dormant. Christians, my friends, must be growing in Jesus Christ. The Bible says that the path of the just is like a shining light that shines more and more into a perfect day. Christians, my friends, are to become better each and every day. Then came the Baptists, and they say no more sprinkling with so-called holy water. The only thing that we sprinkle is clothes, and we sprinkle our garden. It's baptism by immersion. A man must be baptized in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. A man must be buried in water, because baptism, my friends, is a symbol of death to the old way and burial of the old man and resurrection to walk in newness of life. Unfortunately, my friends, some of us were buried alive and we come back kicking. And that is why there is so much problems in the church. The church that God has established to dwell upon present truth, we are divided, we are fragmented. Reason be, some of us were buried alive. And so today, my friends, God is inviting us to be dead to ourselves and to be alive in Jesus Christ. Immediately after that came John Wesley preaching holiness unto the Lord should be our watchword and our song. Holiness unto the Lord as we travel along. God has called us into holiness, my friends. Otherwise, we will only come to church on Sabbath. We cannot keep Sabbath holy if we are not holy. Bible tells us that the law of God is holy. God is holy. And God says, be ye holy because I am holy. Our only duty down here, my friends, is to keep the commandments of God and make sure that we are holy, even as Jesus Christ is holy. Don't come telling me that we cannot be holy, because the word of God says that he that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as Jesus Christ himself is righteous. And so after that came William Miller, the forerunner to the pioneers. William Miller came along and he preached the second coming of Jesus Christ with excitement. He was longing for the coming of Jesus. He looked for the coming of Jesus. He wasn't like us, my friend. He immersed himself in the Word of God. Today, we immerse ourselves in Facebook. We immerse ourselves in our mobile phones. We walk with our mobile phones and we text as we go along. But William Miller immersed himself in the Word of God. And he came, my friends, excitingly preaching and proclaiming the second coming of Jesus. William Miller saw Jesus as his Lord and his Savior. William Miller saw Jesus as someone that he wanted to spend eternity with, and he would have nothing to do with what's happening down here. How excited are we today about the coming of Jesus? Immediately after that came the pioneers. And the pioneers, they are gathering truth as well. They came with the sanctuary that was buried under the rubbles of paganism. The sanctuary emerges again, my friends, teaching us that there is righteousness by faith in Jesus Christ. And so they taught and they preached and they established themselves in the sanctuary service. Not only that, but they came and they gathered the state of the dead. They say no more praying to dead saints because they are dead. The Bible says that the living know that he, but the dead know not. And so we preach the state of the dead. Many today, my friends, are preaching that you are burying the dead and the dead is in heaven looking down. How does that work? I don't know. But the Bible says, my friends, that when a man die, he is dead. And so whatsoever you've got to do, my friends, do it now. Don't wait until you are dead. I believe that's the reason why evangelist Gary Harrison went about the place preaching. God must have given him an instinct that said to him that you're gonna die soon. You see, some of us, my friends, we are here to run marathon. But some of us, it's just a quick sprint. And so let me say to you today, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it doesn't matter how young you are, it is now time to seek the Lord. Nobody knows when he or she will come to the end. And so after that, the Bible tells us that the end is upon us. End time people, my friends, must focus on the Ten Commandments. And I light the seventh-day Sabbath. You're silent. Let me say that again. I say end time people must focus on the commandments of God, and I light the seventh-day Sabbath. Today we are living in a world that is gone mad, in a world that is gone crazy, in a world that anything will do. And God is looking for a man that he can rely on. God is looking for an Elijah. God is looking for a Daniel. Dear to be a Daniel. Dear to stand alone. Dear to have a purpose firm. And dear to make it known. God is looking for a man, my friends. A man who will stand up on the principle of righteousness. A man who will not bend to the right nor to the left. A man who will not compromise. A man who will follow Jesus whithersoever he goes. God is looking for that man today. Is that man you? Is that woman you? God is looking. And so, thus saith the Lord, keep ye judgment and do justice, for my salvation is near to come. God is saying that Jesus is about to come to redeem his chosen few, and my righteousness will be revealed. Blessed is the man that doeth this, the son of man that layeth hold on it, that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting it, and keepeth his hands from doing evil. How good are we today at keeping God's Sabbath holy? Are we polluters of God's Sabbath? Are we only churchgoers? Or are we only pious on Sabbath, but during the course of the week we live like criminals? God is not looking for a one day with his people. God is looking for full custody of his children every step of the way. And so his righteousness, my friends, is about to be revealed. But he is saying that it is time for us to be establishing established truth that was gathered and presented unto us. I wish I had time, my friends, to show you the great conflict of this seventh-day Sabbath. The time is coming, my friends, that if you will not stand for the truth of God, that you will fall for anything. And so in this time of political correctness, I'm come by to let you know that the Sabbath of God is tied up in this great conflict. People are trying to bring about what is known as ecumenism, and they are trying to sensitize us and to groom us into believing that Sunday is the same as Sabbath. Can I change that? They are trying to get us to believe that the first day of the week is the same as the seventh day. That is far from the truth, my friends. Because when we come to the Sabbath is not a separate entity from the day. The day is the Sabbath day. So you can't remove the Sabbath from the day and put it on another day. Wherever the day goes, the Sabbath goes along. It's like me. The Bible says that the Ethiopian cannot change his skin. Yeah? So you can take me out of Africa and put me into Europe, but my Africanness is still pronounced. It's the same thing with the Sabbath, my friends. You can do anything that you want with the day, but it remains God's holy Sabbath. God is calling on a people today not to be gathering truth, but a people who are established in the truth of God to go forward with power and with might under the bloodstained banner of Prince Emmanuel, showing to the world that God is creator. Our last message is fear God and give glory unto him, for the hour of his judgment is come. Worship, my friends. Worship is the big issue today. It doesn't matter what's happening in the world. It's about worship. Satan is clever. And so he employ and deploy the military. He employ parliament. And he employ religious powers. They are fighting to do away with the Sabbath of God. But you and I, who are established in the truth of God, we must do everything that lies in our power to uphold the commandments of God, to uphold the truth of God. We must do what lies in our power to lift up God's Sabbath higher than it has ever been lifted before.
All blessed with that presentation. Shall we stand for the benediction?
Shall we pray? Father in heaven, we thank you that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. We thank you also that you have established us in the truth of your righteousness. I pray now, Lord, that you will lift up your countenance and make your sweet face to shine upon your people. May you give us a zeal and a determination that is second to none, to go forward and to lift up the name of Jesus Christ higher than it has ever been lifted before. May you give us strength and courage. May you give us the power and the might to lift up your truth and to establish it in this world that is now engulfed in darkness. Father, we thank you for the preservation of this truth and ask that thy will be done through us. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, I truly want to thank the Lord that we still have a high priest in the sanctuary. And he ministers on your behalf and on my behalf, and his great desire is to save us. But salvation has always required cooperation. And it's because of that that it is evident we are still here on this earth because of the lack of cooperation. I can assure you that Jesus longs to bring us home. Amen. Our goal is that we must live lives that are in harmony with his will. You know, I've come to love that man, Jesus. Amen. Brothers and sisters, he has truly become my best friend. Amen. And I find it a privilege to tell you of his story. And I believe God wants us to understand something very special as we consider this thing called the great controversy. But as we prepare our hearts to receive what God so greatly wants to give, the only way we can truly have ears to hear is we have to pray. We have to pray. And I believe the most appropriate way to do that in public or private worship is to do that prayer on our knees. And therefore, I'm going to invite you that if you are able to, I would like to invite you to please kneel with me as we approach the Lord in prayer. And if you can't kneel, then you go ahead and bow your heads where you are. But if you can kneel, let's kneel together. Let's approach the Lord. Loving Father, we are grateful for the wonderful things that you want to reveal unto us through your word. And Lord, we're so grateful that though the gospel is so powerful, it is also very simple. And it's our desire to see the simplicity of the gospel as we prepare our hearts to open your word. But first, we ask you for the forgiveness of our sins. We pray that you'll please cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and that you will grant us the presence of your Holy Spirit, that he may come and he may teach us, and that our eyes will be opened and we will truly see wondrous things from the word of God. Lord, I commit myself into your hands afresh. I pray that you will take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. May you minister to my mind, speak through my mouth, and reach the hearts of my brothers and sisters. And while you'll be blessing many others, my prayers, please don't pass me by. Grant me a fresh revelation of Jesus. Help me to see his wonderful majesty and glory. And may all of our hearts, as a result of beholding Christ, by beholding, help all of us to become changed. This is our prayer that we do ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, I read in a little book quite some years ago, and the little book had a statement that I think is very relevant to us today. That book was called Evangelism, and when I was reading it, it had a very powerful statement. And what it stated on page 363 is it says, in place of so much sermonizing, it says, what God's people need to do is study text by text to know what they believe. And I'm, brothers and sisters, I'm here, and I'm here to ask you a very important question. Are you ready to study? Yes. I'm here to study the Word of God, and I want to study it with you. And therefore, this is the time you want to take your Bibles out. You want to take pen and paper out. You want to ask God to give you a mind that you can follow as we prepare to open up and dissect the Word of God. I was so moved this morning as I heard my brother proclaim God's holy Sabbath day of rest. And I was touched just to see how God's truth is very much still alive and still powerful. And I just said, Lord, grant me, if not the same portion, by your grace, double portion of that spirit as I prepare to go ahead and give your word. And I pray God will give triple portion to his servant as he speaks this afternoon. And so it is that I want you to turn your Bibles to the book of Revelation chapter 12. It is in Revelation, the 12th chapter, that the Bible tells us this incredible story of which we have termed the great controversy. And in Revelation, the 12th chapter, I want you to see what the Bible says as we consider just a few verses from it. And when you get there, please say amen. Amen. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 12, and we'll go ahead and start right at verse 7. And the Bible says in Revelation chapter 12, and there was war in heaven. It says, Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. And the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not, and neither was their place found any more in heaven. You know, I remember growing up a very irreligious child. I remember growing up in a home where there was no Christianity, there was no worship, there was no church attendance or anything of the sort. We did what we want, when we want, how we want. As far as I was concerned, I was my own God. But even at that irreligious state of my life, anytime somebody mentioned heaven, I knew one thing for sure, I never thought about it being a place where war took place. That was the one thing that never crossed my mind when I thought about heaven. From a child, even being irreligious and totally outside of the word and will of God, there was never a time that you could have convinced me that fighting took place in a place called heaven. But the Bible tells us the truth, that it was right in heaven that a war broke out, a great controversy. And the controversy was between two characters. What were their names? Michael, and what was the other one? The dragon. And the dragon we're going to find in verse 9 is none other than Satan himself. And here it is that the Bible makes it clear that there was a war in heaven. There were two characters that were involved in the war. One's name is Michael, the other one is the dragon, but we'll see shortly that he is actually known as Satan. Now, Satan is very easy to understand, but Michael is not. It is for that reason that we're going to entertain the question, who exactly is Michael anyhow? Who is Michael? Because I think that in order for us to understand what we're about to view, we need to make sure that we have everything straight as we go text by text through Scripture. The Bible tells us that there was a being called Michael, and we need to understand who he is because there is a lot of conflict on who is this person, who is this being, and what is his role. In fact, you will find that the Bible tells us something very important. You see, when the Bible was put together, it was not put together in obviously the Western tongue that we have. It was written in original languages of Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. And in the Greek, when you look up the word Michael, it actually meant this as it relates to the archangel. It says this word archangelos, it means chief or ruling angel. Now, I want you to hold on to that. Whoever this being Michael is, he is a chief or ruling angel. And the reason why this was important to me is because I'm searching through Scripture to try to understand what else can I find about this person named Michael. Well, I want you to notice something here. When we consider the book of Colossians chapter 1, the Bible says in Colossians 1:16, talking about Jesus, it says, for by him, talking about Jesus, were all things created that are where? In heaven. Now, were angels in heaven? So who created them? Jesus. So notice, the Bible makes it clear that Jesus was the one that created the angels, yes? So notice, it says, for by him, Jesus, were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. It is because of this fact that now Hebrews 1 makes perfect sense when we read in Hebrews 1 and verse 6 that it says, and let all the angels of God worship him. So therefore, Christ was the one that was the chief or the ruler of the angels of which he made. It goes a little deeper than that, because then I perused over to a book called Daniel. And when I went to the book of Daniel, I noticed that in Daniel chapter 10, it also talked about this being named Michael. It created a little confusion for face value. You see, when it says, but lo, Michael, one of the chief princes came to help me. Well, when you read that one of the chief princes, it makes it sound like there's other people around him that are also equal to him. Is that right? But when I read my Bible in the book of Isaiah 45, it tells me there is none that is equal to God. There is none that can stand side by side by God. So therefore, I had to go ahead and dig a little deeper. And when I began to look it up, that word one caught my attention because it says one of the chief princes. So I started to look and I said, all right. When I looked up the word one, I saw something very beautiful. When the word one was used for Michael, it says one, but it actually means as an ordinal. When you think of ordinal, think of order. And it says as an order, it says he was the first of the princes that stands alone. He has nobody that is on par with him. Are you following? So when I think about this being named Michael, I cannot help but to understand this must be none other than Jesus Christ. So when we think about Michael and the dragon fought, we are actually understanding the word of God to tell us something very important. You see, in Isaiah 9 and verse 6, in Acts 3, verses 14 and 15, in Acts 5, in verses 30 and 31, they all refer to Jesus as a prince. So there is none other than Christ that makes up this archangel, the ruler, the chief, over all the other angels by which they worship him. It was Jesus that Satan said that he will fight. And brothers and sisters, that is an arrogant and bold statement when a creation will battle its creator. And so it is that the Bible tells us that there was a war in heaven. There was a war. Now, brothers and sisters, you have to understand. You're going to see in a moment, there's no way that this war could have been a fist fight. Because who in the world can out-strengthen God? God, with one blink of his eye, could have turned Lucifer into a pillar of dust. So when we think about the battle that was going on, it had to be a battle of a totally different nature than what you and I understand when we think of warfare. So when the Bible tells us that there was war in heaven, there was a great controversy. It started in heaven. The characters that are caught in the fight is none other than Jesus and Satan. If you're following thus far, let me hear you say amen. All right, so now what we're going to do is we're going to consider the fact that the Bible makes it very clear that the great controversy is between Christ and Satan. Amen? All right, so now we understand it. We're understanding the story more carefully. The battle is between Christ and who? Satan. Very good. Now we're back in Revelation 12. When we go back to Revelation, the 12th chapter, the story continues. We stopped at verse 8. We're going to pick up at verse 9. The Bible continues to say in Revelation 12 and verse 9, it says, and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out where? Into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So when individuals try to profess this lie that he was cast into hell, that is not biblical. The Bible says he was cast where? Into the earth. Is that clear? So notice he was cast down to the earth. Now, as a result of Satan losing the fight that took place in heaven, the war, and here it is that he's being cast down to the earth, then the Bible transitions and makes another point as we consider Revelation 12, and we're going to look at now verse 12. As a result of Satan and his angels, which we can easily call demons, the Bible says that when he was kicked out of heaven, he was cast down to the earth. And now notice what the Bible says in Revelation 12 and verse 12. It says in Revelation 12, verse 12, therefore rejoice ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. It says, but woe to the inhabitants of where? The earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down now unto who? Unto you, having great wrath, because he knows that he has but a short time. Man, I remember one time I was in school. And I remember I was in school and I remember watching somebody that just walked up to another man and he just walked up and just hit him. And when he hit the guy, I remember the guy said something that just resonated in my mind as I read this story. When the man got hit, He was looking back at the person who assaulted him, and he said unto him, he said, what did I do that made you want to hit me? And the person said, I just wanted to hit you because I wanted to. And I thought about that. That story came in my mind as I'm reading this because I'm thinking, what did we do to pick a fight with Satan? We didn't do anything. We were innocent like that man who was just minding his business at school. We didn't go around saying, the devil is my enemy and I'm after him. Nobody, I would imagine, came out of their mother's womb making such declarations. But brothers and sisters, the Bible says the devil has come down unto us. And it says that he has great wrath because he knows that he has but a short time. And my question is, why is it that Satan wants to attack us? The great controversy was between who? Christ and Satan. So why does he want me? Notice what the Bible says as we consider the book of Isaiah, chapter 63. You see, the Bible tells us something very important in the book of Isaiah, the 63rd chapter. The great controversy did not end in heaven. It just continues on earth. And the Bible says in the book of Isaiah, the 63rd chapter, why is it that Satan now wants to come after us? What did we do that has earned his merits of hatred towards us? I want you to see what the Bible says in Isaiah, the 63rd chapter. The Bible says in Isaiah 63, and when you get there, please say amen. The Bible says in Isaiah 63, starting at verse 8, notice, it says, for he said, surely they are my people. It says, children that will not lie. And it says, so he was their savior. Talking about God. Now watch verse 9. It says in verse 9, in all their affliction. Who's the there? That's God's people, us. It says, in all their affliction. How does the verse finish? It says, who was afflicted? He was afflicted. So notice, in all their affliction, it says he was afflicted. It says, and the angel of his presence saved them in his love and in his pity. He redeemed them and he bare them and carried them all the days of old. You see, my friends, we need to understand the great controversy started in heaven. The great controversy was between Christ and Satan. The great controversy, however, landed on earth and continues on the earth. And Satan now is coming after us. But the rationale in his mind of why he comes after us is because he knows that every time he hurts us, he hurts God. Every single time he gets you and I to fall into sin, every single time he gets you and I to choose him rather than Christ, it's like he literally looks in Christ's face and says, look what I did to another one of your servants. I told you I like to read books. And I remember I was reading another little book. And I was reading a book that had a most profound statement. And that book made something very clear to my mind. That book showed me something about Satan's greatest satisfaction. And when I was reading this book, I noticed a statement that I, by the grace of God, will never forget. It stated the only satisfaction. What satisfaction? It says the only satisfaction Satan takes in playing the game of life for the souls of men is the satisfaction he takes in hurting the heart of Christ. He's not happy when he makes you sick. He's not satisfied when he even has one of us die. He is satisfied when after we get sick, after we die, after we commit sin, then it's as if he puts his foot on our back in triumph and looks Jesus right in the face and says, here's another soul that you wasted your time dying for. The only satisfaction that comes in Satan's heart is when he can play the game of life with you and I, and then he looks at how it affects Jesus. Brothers and sisters, you and I need to understand there's more at stake when we sin. So often we consider what sin has done to us. Very rarely do we understand what sin has done to God. Let me tell you something. I stand before you a man married of 17 years, happily, amen. And I know that often when I travel in ministry, I travel with my family. My family's a priority to me. And even in ministry, we said we're going to dedicate ourselves to self-supporting work. We're not going to trust any man to pay us. God is my boss, and the benefits are out of this world. And so it is that we said we're going to serve the Lord and do his will. And brothers and sisters, there are times where I go ahead and elect to choose and say, honey, you go ahead and stay back because we also have four precious children. And therefore, my wife will stay back and continue homeschooling with the children, and I'll go ahead and travel away. And brothers and sisters, you don't understand. When I'm away from my wife, I'm not the same man. I am not the same man. I mean, I can function. I talk. I have sense. Don't get me wrong. But I'm not the same man. There's a longing in my heart to see the one that I've been separated from. So when I'm away from my bride, no matter how much I love God's people, which I really do, I just want to let you know that while I love you and love spending time with you, I am counting the days, the hours, and the minutes. You understand that? Well, here it is that I notice, and to make it worse, when my internet doesn't work, and I can't get in touch with my bride, now, your brother can get a little bit more agitated. You understand? Because that's my only means of communicating. I love my bride, brothers and sisters. You need to understand, I love my wife. I stand before you as a man who does not have to act. I am telling you the truth. I love my bride. And here it is that sometimes we'll go ahead and communicate through text. How are you doing? Oh, I'm doing all right. How are you doing? I'm doing all right. And then sometimes we might do a little FaceTime thing where, you know, 1 minute she's talking to me and her face freezes. But then there eventually gets to a point where I don't have that privilege to communicate with her any further, and I have to continue on the task that I've been called to. But brothers and sisters, do you know how much I long for the day when I get back on that airplane, fly across those friendly skies, and I land right there in Logan Airport in Boston, and I get a chance to come out of that plane, get onto that little trail bus, and come out there with my bags and see that van pull up and see those precious pearly teeth, to see those beautiful brown eyes, to see the one that I've dedicated my life to, brothers and sisters. Do you understand how much I long for that experience? And God says, son, magnify it by infinity, and that's how much I'm longing to look my bride in the face. You see, we actually get satisfied with prayer. We actually get satisfied with prayer and hearing God's human agents speak his words. God is looking forward to the day where he can remove prayer, he can remove the human agents, and once again, he can have face-to-face communion with his bride. I said, Lord, now that you allowed me to get married, I understand it like I've never understood it before. And God longs to see us. But we don't understand. When we sin, Isaiah 59 and verse 2, the Bible says, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from us. And we think God is satisfied with a sidebar conversation. God's not satisfied. God wants to be able to look his bride once again in the face. But it can't happen until we get rid of that third party that we've allowed in our lives called sin. It cannot happen, brothers and sisters. It is because of this fact that this is why Christ says that he has to deal with this controversy. This great controversy, brothers and sisters, it is between Christ and Satan, but now we have to understand something very important. The great controversy, it is between Christ and Satan, but now it has a bit of a shift to it. It's still between Christ and Satan, but now we have to understand it's over mankind. The great controversy is between Christ and Satan, but it's over mankind. We have now entered the picture because Satan has dared to say, I'm going to take your children, every single one of them. Now, my question to you is, what would you do as a good parent if somebody tried to take your child? If somebody tried to take your child, would you put a plan of salvation together to save your child? Do you understand, saints? So we're looking at this great controversy. There was a war that started in heaven. It was between Christ and Satan. But it got to a point that as a result of Satan losing the first battle, here it is that now he's kicked out. He lands on earth. And then he looks at God's crowning creation. And then he comes after you and I, his children, because he knows every time he hurts us, it is as if he is getting vengeance on God. So the great controversy now is between Christ and Satan over mankind. Now, when an enemy wants to take a person out, they usually don't aim for legs or anything like that. They usually aim for vital points. Is that right? You know, there's things that happen in the natural world. When we look at the natural world, we understand that when an enemy wants to take somebody out, when they want to take their enemy out, they don't aim for the things where they can survive more than likely after the hit. They aim for the things that are vital, vital organs. Is that right? So therefore, my question then was, what do they really want? The great controversy is between Christ and Satan. Christ wants something. Satan wants something. And the question is, what do they really want? So let's take a look as we dig deeper into this great controversy theme. The Bible tells us something about God. In Proverbs 23 and verse 26, God spelled it out clear as day. God said, my son, give me what? God says, give me thy heart. And the word heart means? Mind. My son, give me thy heart or mind, and let thine eyes observe my ways. So notice, what does God want? He wants our heart, but more clearly, in our more common vernacular, we would say God really wants our minds. Now, watch this. Again, the Bible's second witness. Notice what it says next. In Romans 12 and verse 2, you know the text, I would imagine. The Bible says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by what? The renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So notice that God wants our what? Mind. Now, this is what the Bible is revealing to us. God wants our mind because God understands that there's a lion that wants something else. You see, the Bible tells us in the book of 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8, it says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. So notice that the devil, he is after us, and he wants to devour us, but I wondered if he had a specific target point. Notice what the Bible continues to say. Now think about it. God told us to be sober and to be vigilant because of the fact that there's a lion-like beast that is coming after us by the name of Satan. So then I started to think about it. All right. Well, then how do you look at this? In 1 Peter 1:13, the Bible says, wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind. Be what? Sober. Now, please, do me a favor. Go to the book of Ephesians chapter 6. Because, you know, sometimes you have a tendency to, when you see phraseology in the Bible, certain words, sometimes you start, you know, a thought comes into your mind and makes you think and say, hey, wait a minute, that's mentioned someplace else in the Bible. So notice what the Bible says as we look at Ephesians chapter 6. In the book of Ephesians, the 6th chapter, I want you to notice what the Bible says as we consider starting at verse 12. The Bible says in Ephesians 6 and verse 12, and if you're there, please let me know by saying amen. Amen. In fact, look at verse 11 for even better context. The Bible says in the book of Ephesians, chapter 6, starting at verse 11, it says, put on the whole what? Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Then it says in verse 13, wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with what? Well, wait a minute. That's words that come exactly from 1 Peter 1. We just read in 1 Peter 1, wherefore, gird up the loins of your what? Mind. So God wants us to fortify our minds with truth. Come on, saints. So this is what God says. Fortify your mind with truth. Why? Because Satan says that's his target point. Think about that. The great controversy is between Christ and Satan, but it's over mankind, and they both want man's mind. You understand? You understand? It's a serious battle, brothers and sisters. I wonder who we lend our minds to every day. What's your focus every day? What do you listen to every day? What is it that you fill your minds with every day? Because now we understand that whatever I put in front of my face, you know there are avenues to that mind. There are things that we see. There's things that we hear. There's things that we touch. There's things that we smell. And there's things that we taste. And all of these things are avenues that lead to this mind. And the Bible lets us know Satan is after your mind. That I hope you think twice the next time you eat. I hope you think twice the next time you drink. I hope you think twice the next time you decide to listen to music or anything else. You have to understand, wait a minute, before I listen to this, how will this affect my mind? Now watch this. The great controversy is between Christ and Satan, but it's over mankind, and they both want man's mind. So God says we must gird our minds with the truth. This is why God consistently brings up the truth. And that's why we heard this morning so much about the present truth. Because God understands the warfare, he needs us as his people to understand the warfare. Are you following so far? Yes. So now let's continue. So now, here's the question. When Satan wanted to attack man or attack Christ, we know that he tried to work through men, Adam and Eve and all sorts of individuals all throughout history. But you know that Jesus came on the scene, didn't he? And when Jesus came on the scene, Satan said, demons, you are not qualified for this fight. He said, I'll take this one myself. And therefore, he came and he consistently pressed against Jesus. And it appeared as if he won because ultimately, did Jesus die? Yes. Did Satan want to kill him? Yes. But what did he use to do it? You see, this is the point that I want us to consider. Satan always wanted to hurt Christ. That was always his focus. You and I, unfortunately, are just caught in the middle of this thing. You understand? Now, because of this fact, I began to look at it and I said, well, let's think about it. What exactly was Satan's stratagem in killing Jesus Christ? What was his stratagem? What was the deceptive method and way that he put together to say, I want to take out Jesus, and I want you to watch this. He wants to get your mind, and he wants to get my mind because he understands something. Go to Proverbs 23, and let me show you what Satan understood. Satan understands this, and God understands it too. Perhaps it is that we don't understand it. The Bible says in Proverbs, the 23rd chapter, and when you get there, let me know by saying amen. Amen. The Bible says in Proverbs 23, consider the verse in verse 7. We're just going to look at the first sentence in it. The Bible says in Proverbs 23, notice what it says as we consider verse 7, and if you're there, please say amen again. The Bible says in Proverbs 23 and verse 7, it says, for as he thinketh in his heart, what's the word heart mean? So as he thinketh in his mind, what does the Bible say? So is he. So notice, the great controversy is between Christ and Satan, and it's over mankind, because they both want access to man's mind, because whoever has the mind has the man. You understand that? And whoever has the mind, that's whose image will reflect. So the great controversy really is between Christ and Satan over mankind to receive his mind that man may reflect one or the other's character. Are you following? We're studying the great controversy. So now notice this. So as we're looking at this, I started thinking about it. I said, well, wait a minute. When you look at Jesus, what was Satan's stratagem in killing Christ? He couldn't beat him in heaven, but he said, I'm going to try to beat him on earth. But I want you to notice how he succeeded, at least when it came to killing him, his body, and destroying him as it relates to the earth. Watch the text here. In Psalm 69 and verse 20, this one I'm putting on the screen. In Psalm 69 verse 20, this is what you call a messianic psalm. It's a psalm, though written by David, but it's talking about none other than Jesus Christ. It's talking about the Messiah. Now watch what Jesus, through inspiration, was saying about himself as it relates to how he was going to die. The Bible says, reproach hath done what? Reproach hath broken my heart, and I looked for some to take pity, but there was none, and for comforters, but I found none. Does that not sound like the very story of Jesus? Jesus was at one point abandoned by everybody, and he had to go ahead and stand alone, but thank God he wasn't alone. Heaven was with him. And so it is, brothers and sisters, that Christ perfectly matches this. Jesus died, according to Scripture, from what we call and what the Bible calls a broken heart. And the thing that broke Christ's heart was reproach. So obviously I'm going through my study and I'm thinking reproach. Pull out the concordance. Where's reproach? And I'm looking for reproach in the Bible. And lo and behold, I found Proverbs 14:34. Do you know what the Bible calls reproach? Because reproach is what killed Christ. And the Bible says in Proverbs 14 and verse 34, the text says, righteousness exalteth a nation, but what? But sin is a reproach to any people. Jesus did not die because of thorns on his brow. Jesus did not die because of a spear put in his side. Jesus died, my brothers and sisters, of a broken heart. And what was it that broke his heart? It was the very ones that he loved that he came to die for, and they treated his death like dung and would prefer to sin. And it was sin that killed the Savior, not his sins, because the Bible says he was tempted in all points and never sinned. It was our sins. Our sins killed the Messiah. Our sins killed the Savior. Satan would have thought to himself that he had triumphed. But God says, no, you didn't triumph. You just won a battle, but you did not win the war. And therefore, the Bible makes it very clear that the great controversy is between Christ and Satan. And Christ and Satan are having the battle over mankind. And they both want what from mankind? His mind. Because they want the mind, because whoever has the mind has the man. And we will reflect their image. So watch this. You would think at Calvary, Satan was having tremendous success, wouldn't you? Because it was the sins of the people that caused Jesus to have to go to that cross. But here it is that I want you to see something now. One of the things we're going to have to do that I believe is very fundamental to those of us in the room, as well as to those who are viewing, is we need to go ahead and methodically go through Scripture to understand what is sin. So let's do that very quickly. So what is God's definition of sin? Well, the Bible makes that very clear. It says sin is the transgression or the breaking of God's law. 1 John 3:4. So notice that sin is the breaking of God's what? God's law. Then the Bible makes it clear even more so. Which law? Because there were 613 laws in the Bible. So which law is it that if we break it, it is sin? Well, the Bible does not leave us aloof to this question. It says, by the law is the knowledge of sin. Then it goes on to tell us, it says, and I had not known sin, but by the law. I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not what? covet. So whatever law says thou shalt not covet is the law that if I break it, the Bible calls it sin. Then the Bible lets us know, obviously, the law that says that is none other than the 10th commandment in the 10 commandments found right there in Exodus chapter 20 and verse 17, thou shalt not covet. So Satan's master plan, Satan's stratagem is keep the people in sin and he keeps the pain in Christ's heart. This is his side of this great controversy. You know, if I were to ask people, intelligent people, if I were to ask intelligent people, if I were to say, do you want to break the heart of God? I believe intelligent people would say, no, I don't want to do that. But then if you begin to show them what sin is, and you begin to point them to those testing sins, especially the Sabbath day truth, you begin to give the Sabbath truth and say, would you be willing to demonstrate your love to God by honoring him and reverencing him, not by keeping 7, 8, or even 9, but all of his commandments, including the holy Sabbath day of rest? Would you be willing to do it, my friend? And all of a sudden they say, oh, no, I'm not willing to do that. I was born a Baptist, I'm a die a Baptist. I was born a Roman Catholic, I'm a die a Roman Catholic. And I've heard people say that. And brothers and sisters, we don't understand. That is a position of death. When a man is so dedicated to his religion that he will literally overlook the clear, plain statements of the Word of God, brothers and sisters, that is a position of death. And it's also a position of pain. They will die, but they also put pain on the heart of Christ, of which they just said a few moments ago, oh, no, I would never want to put pain on God. You see, my friends, we have to do a very deep heart searching to really understand this great controversy. And so it is that we looked at Satan's stratagem. He wants to keep us and get us to fall in sin, to keep breaking the heart of God, and ultimately he's going to seek to win the war. But now my next question is this. What was God's plan to destroy the devil? You see, they both had a plan. Satan, he put together his stratagem, and he said, this is how I'm going to take Christ out. But did you know God has a stratagem? And he says, this is how I'm going to take Satan out. Did you know that? I want to show you that. Go to the book of Genesis chapter 3. You see, it was right there in Genesis, the 3rd chapter, and I want you to see verse 15. This is God's plan now. We saw Satan's plan, but now we're going to look at God's plan. What was God's plan to take care of his enemy? And I want you to see how the Bible spells it out in Genesis 3. It was after Adam and Eve fell into sin. It was after they had fallen and even the very DNA in them changed. Here it is that the Bible shows that God already had a plan in place from the foundation of the world. But now he was making it known in most profound manner as we look at Genesis chapter 3, and we're going to consider verse 15. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 3 and verse 15, it says, and I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. So God says, I have a plan. This is a covenant that God has presented to his people by which he says, this is how I'm going to end up winning the war. He says, I'm going to put enmity between thee and the woman and between thy seed and her seed. And it shall bruise thy head. But it says, and you shall bruise the heel, but it's going to bruise your head. Now watch this. Let's identify these characters more carefully because there's 4 characters in Genesis 3:15. In Genesis 3:15, you have the eye. Who is this eye? Who's that? Then you have the woman, then you have the seed, and then you have the serpent. These are the 4 characters that we see in Genesis 3:15. We need to understand who these characters are so we can go through this thing methodically. So now, number one, who is the I that was talking? Well, that was none other than God. All you got to do is look at the previous verse. In the previous verse, in verse 14, it was God himself, and the Lord said. And then next thing you know, in verse 15, the Lord is continuing to say, he says, and I will put. So the I is none other than God. This is an important point. You cannot fight Satan on your own. You cannot beat Satan with mere determination. You cannot hate sin or hate evil just because you had a bad experience. Do you know how many people I know that will literally practice sin and they will cry with deep tears and literally say, I hate sin, I will never do it again, and tomorrow go right back to it? You understand that? It's called being a slave. You understand that? That's why you need to understand the I. Sometimes we read Genesis 3:15 and we bypass the other pieces and we forget the I. God says, I'm the one that's going to put hatred in your heart for sin. You can't hate sin no matter how hard you try. I heard the eloquent statement mentioned earlier, can the Ethiopian change his skin? And the answer is no. Can the leper change his spots? The answer is no. And then the next question was, well, how can you go ahead and do good when you're accustomed, taught to do evil. Jeremiah 13:23. So therefore, the Bible makes it clear, no, you can't do these things on your own. The only way you can hate sin and hate Satan is you need God to put something in you that is naturally not in any of us. So the I is very important. But then also the woman. The woman is none other than God's people or the church. Because it says in Jeremiah 6:2, I have likened the daughter of Zion to a comely and delicate woman. And then in Isaiah 51 and verse 16, it says, say unto Zion, thou art my people. So notice that God says, I'm going to do something. I'm going to put enmity or hatred between thee and the woman. So God says that he's going to do something for his church, in his church, that we could never do for ourselves. In his people, he says, I'm going to literally put hatred in your heart for the things of the devil. Then who's the seed? The seed is none other than Christ. The Bible says in Galatians 3 and verse 16, it tells us very clearly that God did not make the promises unto seeds, plural, but unto one seed. And that seed was Jesus Christ. Then the serpent. Well, we just went over that in Revelation 12 and verse 9. The serpent is none other than Satan himself. So these are the characters that is in the midst of this promise that God says, listen, I am going to put enmity between thee and the woman, and I am going to do these things. And he says, and a point is going to come where I'm going to crush your head. This is literally what God said. God says, I am going to crush the serpent's head. Now, I happen to live in the countryside in the United States. And in the country, in Georgia especially, there were many, many snakes, and many of them were venomous. And I remember the first time I saw a snake, and I looked at it and I said, well, look at that. And I saw the snake, and I said, all right, it's time to take it out. And you know, you get your stick and you start trying to beat it, and that thing just slithering around and moving around, and you know, you don't have your bearings right. And I remember my son, Caleb. Caleb came and he said, Daddy, he says, don't worry. He says, I'll get it. Caleb came and he took that axe, and he took the axe and he switched it on the blunt side. And Caleb just used those sharp young eyes that he had, and he just went 1, 2, 3, bop, and he hit it right on the head. And that serpent's head was crushed, and the serpent was dead. God says a time is going to come where he says, I'm going to crush the serpent's head. And you know what I believe? I believe the most important question that any of us should long for when we hear God prophetically tell us that Satan's head is going to be crushed, I believe the greatest question that we should ask Jesus is, when? When, Lord? When will this great, grand, glorious day will come? And guess what? When the head is crushed, the war is over. When the head is crushed, the controversy is over. Are you following? We're talking about a great controversy, my brothers and sisters. Satan started it, but God says, you started it, but I'm going to finish it. And God makes it clear that he's going to finish this war. I am so excited that I'm on the Lord's side. How about you? You see, God has made it clear. He says, I'm going to finish this war. I'm going to bring it to an end. I will crush the head of that serpent. But the question is, when? When will you do it, Lord? When will it take place? You know, I used to ask a lot of Christians that. Do you believe that the serpent's head has been crushed? Do you believe that his head has been crushed? And do you know a lot of Christians would tell me? You know what they would say? They would say, yes. They would say, yes, I believe his head was crushed. And I would say, when? Because I should have known this. And I said, when? And they said, at the cross. I said, at Calvary, huh? I said, well, let's take a look at it. So we started to go to Calvary. So when I started studying Calvary, I did look at it carefully. I found the point of confusion. In other words, the person was very innocent in their declaration, but there was a point of confusion. Let me show you the point of confusion. You see, what we have to understand is the Bible does give a language that does make it appear like his head was crushed at the cross. Let me show you what the verse is. It's right here in Hebrews 2:14. Look at the verse. The verse does say, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same. Talking about Jesus. It says that through what? Now, when did death take place? Took place on the cross, right? So then it says, so that through death he might what? Destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. So does it not look like the devil was destroyed at the cross? Yes or no? If you look at the verse for face value, the verse looks like it's saying that the devil, he was destroyed at the cross. Does it not? So how do you clear it up? I tell you, you know, I said I like reading books. I was reading a little book. His book is called Education, and I was reading it in page 190, and it said that whenever you study the scripture, it says you should study the scripture as a whole and see how it relates to other parts of the scripture. In other words, you never develop a belief system by just looking at a verse standing by itself. You always look at the whole of the picture. Is that right? So what did I do? I started looking at the whole. So here it is. It's true. We know this verse is not lying. That's not the issue. It's not lying. It's just that with all our getting, we need to get some understanding. So yes, it is true. It says, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. That is true. But when I began to look at other portions of the scripture, I landed on 1 John 3 and verse 8. And the Bible says in 1 John 3:8, he that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Now that made a bit more sense for me. Jesus, when he died, brothers and sisters, it was as if he made secure that the same way I had victory over sin is the same way you can, that the works of the devil will not have to have dominion over you anymore. That's why Jesus said in John 16 and verse 33, he said, be of good cheer. He says, I have overcome the world. And in Christ, we can overcome. Wait a minute. Does that not bring us back to our very opening verse? It was in Revelation 3:5 that the Bible said, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. And God said that beautiful statement. He said, and I will not blot out their names out of the book of life. That's what we all want, brothers and sisters. That's what we want. Christ says, I have overcome. Now that I have overcome, I have now secured your opportunity that you can overcome, and the works of the devil can be destroyed. Now, brothers and sisters, this gets sweet. So, yes, it is true that I understand why people say his head was crushed at the cross. I believe the crushing process started at the cross. But his head's not crushed yet. So, therefore, we're back to our question again. When will his head finally be crushed? What will it take so that his head will be crushed? I was disturbed tremendously when I am in Edmonton, in London, and I just happened to ask the pastor, because, you know, I like to ask questions about where I'm at. So I said, listen, I said, tell me about this area. What's this area like? And as I'm in this area, he said, this area is known as Shankville. Shankville? Now, you know, I'm from Queens, New York, and I spent a lot of time in Brooklyn. And my nephew, Charlie, and my sister Laverne and all them, they lived in Brownsville, Brooklyn, New York. And Brownsville had a nickname. It was called Murderville. So I understood Murderville. I was like, Shanksville? What is Shanksville? And he said, in other words, the greatest crimes that are committed are used with knives. And they shank or cut or stab people. I said, is that right? And then he said, yeah. He says, not very long ago, he says, some guy just went to a woman and literally severed her head from her body. I said, are you serious? He said, yeah, just random. The lady's outside just doing a gardening, minding her business. And she loses her life and her head. And I thought to myself, I said, this is where we are in society today. This is where we are. We are in society. People don't have to have a reason to kill anymore. Back in the days, at least if someone was murdered, there was a story behind it. Nowadays, the only story that counts is the story from inspiration. You know what's happening? You know what's happening right now? The same thing that happened in 1 Samuel 16 and verse 14. The Bible tells us about King Saul. It says that the Spirit of God departed and an evil spirit came upon him. That's what's happening with many people all over the world. God is striving, God is calling, God is pleading, but as a result of individuals grieving the Spirit of God, they are not able to be sealed in God. And after a while, God will say, Ephraim has joined himself unto idols, leave him alone. And then when God's Spirit withdraws, Satan's spirit takes over. It's happening all around us, brothers and sisters. That's why you dare not leave your home, drive your car, or anything without prayer. You need to commit yourselves afresh to God. Because everything that we do is an exercise of faith. What makes you think somebody won't run a red light? What makes you, brothers, we only have the comfort of knowing that God's presence is with me, and as long as I'm in God's will, I cannot die except it be my time. Brothers, you know how much peace that thing brought to my heart? I used to hate flying on airplanes and all that stuff. I'm always thinking, man, this plane's gonna go down. And here it is, this is what convinced me. I saw every time they tried to kill Jesus, Jesus could not die on outside of any time but on time. He had to be the Passover lamb and die on the 14th day of the first month. He could not die any other time. Brothers and sisters, if you are in the will of God, if you are living a life that is pleasing to him, no matter how hard the devil tries to take you out, he cannot do it except it be your time. But the Bible also says in Ecclesiastes chapter 7 and verse 17, you write that text down. In Ecclesiastes 7, 17, the Bible does say, be not overmuch wicked, neither be thou foolish, for why wilt thou die before thy time? You see, when you do foolish things, you can die before your time. You can die before your time, saints. And that's why I told you, my family and I, we said, you know what? We're going to do a Bible study on foolishness. We said we're going to study everything that God calls foolish because I don't want to do it. You understand that? That makes sense. That's a good study. You should do it too. So therefore, God is saying, listen, I have a plan. I have a whole means by which I'm going to crush the head of the serpent, but we're still asking the Lord when. And then one day, God gave an amazing clue. It was found in the book of Romans chapter 16. Watch this. In Romans the 16th chapter, now I want you to see something that the Bible says. It is ever so clear. Notice what the text says in Romans chapter 16. And when you get there, let me know by saying amen. The Bible says in Romans the 16th chapter, watch the text carefully now. Why is it that Satan's head has not been crushed yet? Is it that God doesn't want to do it? Does God want the beheadings to continue? Does God want the Ebolas and all the other diseases to continue? Does God want all of these things to continue? No, he does not. God is waiting for something, brothers and sisters. And I'm here to let you know right now, we are the holdup. The Bible says in Romans the 16th chapter, and if you're there, let me know by saying amen. The Bible says in Romans the 16th chapter, observe the text, verses 17 to 20. It says, now I beseech you, brethren. Now, let me pause right here. If you look at Romans 16, all the verses before is just a bunch of salutations. That's all the chapters. It's just, I salute you, I salute you, I salute you, I salute you. It's like Paul is just greeting all these brethren from everywhere, and then out of nowhere, he just injects this counsel. So right here is where the counsel just comes in. Everywhere else before, a bunch of hello, 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 hello. And then out of nowhere, he says, hey, I need to tell you something. Watch what he tells us. Verse 17. It says, now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. You hear that? Mark them. This is why you can't play with error, brothers and sisters. The Bible tells us that we should not sit under those who teach us to err from knowledge. The Bible says, going on, it says, now I beseech you, brethren, mark them, observe them, mark them, make it known, expose them, mark them, which cause divisions and offenses, contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple. That word simple means the harmless ones, the innocent ones. Okay? Now it says in verse 19, it says, for your obedience is come abroad unto all men. In other words, your faithfulness has been made known. He's counseling the brethren in the church of Rome. And then he says, for your obedience is come abroad unto all men. I am glad, therefore, on your behalf. But yet I would have you wise unto that which is good and simple concerning evil. Now, I thought at first, I said, is this word simple here the same word as simple in verse 18? And the answer is no. The word simple here in verse 19 is actually a different word. It's similar, but it's different. And it says to be guileless, to be without fault, to have no evil having dominion in your mind. It is a position of victory over sin. Now watch this. After he says, no guile found amongst you, no sin that's dwelling in your mind, he says, stay in this condition. And then notice what he says in verse 20. The continuation says, if they were in this condition, it says, and the God of peace shall do what? Shall bruise Satan under your feet shortly. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. So notice, when God's people enter into an experience with him, God says, after that takes place, he says, then in a short while, I will bruise the head of Satan. I said, now I got to look up that word bruise. And when I looked up that word bruise, brothers and sisters, do you know what that word bruise means? It literally means that God will have Satan's head broken to shivers or to crush completely. God literally said that when my people become wise unto what's good and become simple, innocent, guileless, without any evil, God says, after that experience, shortly thereafter, I will completely crush Satan's head. Brothers and sisters, that's a tall order. That is a tall order. You and I have to understand that. That is a tall order. God is saying that he actually believes and wants to bring you and I into an experience where by his grace, we stop sinning. Amen. We stop sinning. We stop violating the law of God. God says, this is what I'm looking for. This is what I'm looking for. God says, I'm looking for a people that love me so much that they would prefer to die than commit even one sin against me. And with man, this is impossible. But remember, the Bible says, I can do how many things? All things through Christ who strengthens me. With Jesus, through Jesus, it is possible that we can actually hate what he hates and love what he loves. Somebody said one time, how could you describe Jesus in one verse? I said, go to Hebrews 1. You know, sometimes people always say, how do you describe Jesus? Just one verse. I said, all right, go to Hebrews 1. I don't have to honor you, but I'll honor it. I said, I'll do it. No problem. So he said, go ahead, describe Jesus and tell me the image that we need to reflect. I said, go to Hebrews 1 and notice what the Bible says in verse 9. Do you know if we can have the Hebrews 1:9 experience, we can go home? Look at what the Bible says. The Bible says in Hebrews 1 and verse 9, it says, that talking about Jesus, it says, thou hast what? Loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Therefore, God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. If you and I can get to a place that we love what God loves and hate what God hates, God can trust us in his house. God will not have a problem letting us in his house. You see, if a man came to your house and said, hello, I'm deceitful above all things and I'm desperately wicked, may I please come in? How many of you would let a person like that in your house? You would never let a person, not if you got intelligence, is that right? You would never let a person in your house if he said, I'm deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Can I come in, please? We would close that door very quickly. But brothers and sisters, God says, listen, you think I don't know your heart? God says he knows all of our hearts. We're saying when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Brothers and sisters, God says, not while you're in this condition. Not while we are still in this carnal state. It is only until Christ can change us from within out. It is only at that time that God can trust us in his house. But as long as we are in our deceitfully and desperately wicked state, God cannot trust us in his house. So we need to change. We need to change from the inside out. And that's why I love to talk about that thing called victory over sin. You see, when we talk about victory over sin, we're talking about something that is possible through the righteousness of Christ. We're talking about individuals that can have victory over lawlessness, individuals that can truly keep God's commandments, not from an external position, but from an inward, outward position. That we can do like David says, oh, how love I thy law. I meditate upon it all the day. Is that how we treat? Think about it. How many of us honestly could say, oh, Lord, I love thy law. I meditate upon it all the day. Somebody says, how do you meditate on thou shalt not have any other gods before me? And we go on, but we don't understand that God's commandments are exceeding broad. It is the revelation of his character. So when we think about victory over sin, Christ says, this is possible. This is how he says, I need this to happen so I can close the great controversy. He says, I need to bring my people into this experience so that I can finally completely crush the head of the serpent. And he wants to do it. But remember, like I said in the beginning of the message, salvation is always based on cooperation. It's cooperation. God supplies everything, but he will not choose for you. You have to choose. You have to yield. So when you think of victory over sin, we look at it in twofold. Watch the points. Number one, when you think of victory over sin, the first thing God has to give us is he has to give us something called prohibitions. He has to tell us things like, don't do this anymore. And that's why you look at the Ten Commandments, you see more thou shalt nots than thou shalt do. Because we have a tendency to do what we shouldn't do. So therefore, there's going to be prohibitions. But there's another aspect of victory over sin. Another aspect of victory over sin that is perhaps not talked about as much as the prohibitions is a call to action. And I'm going to break that down. Watch this. When you think about prohibitions, you think about texts like Isaiah 1 and verse 16, avoiding evil. Go to the book of Isaiah chapter 1 with me, and let's notice what it says in verse 16. In Isaiah 1 and verse 16, God makes it clear that this is something that he is prohibiting us to do. He's saying, I don't want my people doing this. So observe Isaiah 1 and verse 16. The Bible says in Isaiah the first chapter and the 16th verse, notice what the text says, and when you get there, please say amen. Amen. The Bible says in Isaiah 1 and verse 16, it says, wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes, cease to do evil. Now, brothers and sisters, there are many things that we can do that's evil. But did you know that the Bible even tells us, did you know the Bible actually shows that even, since we're talking about the great controversy, we know the great controversy climaxes on the test question of the Sabbath. Is that right? Did you know that the Bible says cease to do evil? We know that, right? Let me show you Nehemiah chapter 13. We probably didn't know this one. In Nehemiah, the 13th chapter, we have to let people know this, you know. In Nehemiah, the 13th chapter, notice what the Bible says. Nehemiah 13, and I want you to watch the text now as we consider verses 15 to 18. The Bible says in Nehemiah chapter 13, verses 15 to 18. And when you get there, please say amen. The Bible says in Nehemiah 13, verse 15, in those days saw I in Judah some treading wine presses on the Sabbath, and bringing in sheaves and lading asses, as also wine, grapes, and figs, and all manner of burdens, which they brought into Jerusalem on the Sabbath day, and I testified against them in the day wherein they sold victuals. These were individuals who were conducting day-to-day regular business on the Lord's holy Sabbath day of rest. Now, some people today feel like this is inconsequential. Literally, I remember being at a convention where a whole bunch of people were getting ready to go out Friday night to dinner, but they were all Seventh-day Adventists. They were Sabbath keepers. And I said, what are you doing? And they said, well, we're going to go eat dinner. I said, we don't do that. I said, we need to honor God and keep his Sabbath. What are you doing? They said, well, where in the Bible does it say that it's a sin to buy and sell? Where does it say that it's a sin? I said, you know what? I can't necessarily show you a text where it says that it says this is a sin. I said, but I will show you a text where it says this is evil. They said, oh, you can show me that? I said, yeah, I can show you to it. He said, show it to us. So now we're here in Nehemiah 13. Now we're looking at verse 16. It says in verse 16, it says, there dwelt men of Tyre also therein, which brought fish and all manner of ware and sold on the Sabbath unto the children of Judah and in Jerusalem. Now watch verse 17 carefully. It says, then I contended with the nobles of Judah and said unto them, what? What evil thing is this that ye do and profane the Sabbath day? The Bible says that when we conduct our secular business on the Lord's Sabbath day of rest, the Bible says it is an evil thing. And the Bible says cease to do evil. So the first part that we consider when we think about victory over sin is that God wants to bring an experience in yours and my heart by which we no longer do the things that the Bible calls evil. But remember, we also said that it is a call to action. Is that right? So when you think of a call to action, what is that? That is self-sacrificial service. Did you know that when the people of God try to stay away from evil, but they keep their lives void of self-sacrificial service, did you know that the Bible lets us know that that is something that can cause us not to go to heaven? We can be lost. And somebody says, how do you prove that? Well, think about it. We don't have to go over all the verses. You can write them down. But in Isaiah 58, 6 through 12, it's talking about this true fast. And the true fast is based on all of these various services of which we can offer to others and we can help them. Benevolent work. But I want you to look at Matthew 25. You see, in Matthew 25, we can consider the text. The Bible says in Matthew, the 25th chapter, observe the text very carefully. We don't even have to read all the verses. In Matthew 25, 31 to 46, we don't have to read it all, but you can write it down. But in Matthew 25, 31 to 46, let us observe the text. And let's look at verse 41, and we'll take that down to verse 46. The Bible says in Matthew 25, starting at verse 41, and if you're there, please say amen. The Bible says in Matthew 25 and verse 41, it says, then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. It says, for I was an hungered, and you gave me no meat. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you took me not in. Naked, and you clothed me not. Sick, and in prison, and you visited me not. Then shall they also answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee an hungered, or athirst, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, in prison, and did not minister unto thee? And then shall he answer them, saying, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye did it not to one of the least of these, ye did it not to me, and these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. The Bible makes it clear, my brothers and sisters, we cannot live selfish, self-centered lives and sing when we all get to heaven. We would be singing a song of deception. We would be deceiving our own selves. There's a balance, because I know people that will stay away from every evil. Bad music, evil. Bad dress, evil. Bad diet, evil. Bad, bad, bad. Everything's bad, so they stay away from it. But when you try to get them to go ahead and do some self-sacrificial service, all of a sudden they're too busy telling everybody else that they're evil. You understand? God is a God of balance. I plead with him all the time, Lord, teach me to be a balanced Christian. I don't want to go far right. I don't want to go far left. I want to stay right there in the center. My desire is neither to be Pharisee nor Sadducee. My desire is to be Christian. I don't want to be present truth or precious truth. I want to be a child of God. I want to be faithful. There's all these cliques that are constantly developing within our ranks. Brothers and sisters, we need to learn that we are called to reflect the lovely image of Jesus. And Jesus was a man that hated sin. And Jesus was a man that went about doing good. And that is the balance that I want. So therefore, again, this is what produces Christ-likeness. How does these happen? It happens through what's called communion. If you and I understand, because think about it. How do I get to a point that I can hate what God hates? How do I get to a point that I can do what God did? Brothers and sisters, it can't happen until you and I understand what it is to have communion. We got to understand what it is. And I'm not talking about serving plates with grape juice and crackers. I'm talking about communion, time with God. I'm talking about people who know what it is to spend time in the secret chamber with the divine lover of their souls. Individuals who know how to do this, brothers and sisters. In Mark 1:35, the Bible says early in the morning, a great while before day, Jesus would go out and he would find a solitary place and he would talk to his Father. The Bible says in Luke 6 and verse 12, it says sometimes Christ would go find a solitary place and he would pray sometimes all night talking to his Father. I told you that I like books. Another book that I read, a beautiful book, documentary on the life of Christ, Desire of Ages, page 668, and it says so beautifully, when we know God, as it is our privilege to know him, it says our lives will be a life of continual obedience. It says through an appreciation of the character of Christ. Through, watch this, communion with God, it says sin will become hateful to us. My friends, God says, the more that you spend time with me is the more that you'll hate what I'll hate, and you'll do what I do. And you know the beautiful part? It will be supernatural. This is what Christ wants us to understand. It's not hard. Victory over sin is not impossible. It's just that we have to understand the process. Let me go ahead and bring it to a close. I don't want to wear you out. But notice, this is what produces Christ-likeness. Amen? Amen. Amen. So now, let's think about it. How do we get to this Christ-likeness? How? Well, the answer goes back to that text. Remember Genesis 3:15? God says that he's going to put a seed. A seed is going to come in. Now, what do you do with a seed? You plant a seed. Where do you plant a seed in? You plant it in ground, or we plant it in soil. Now, brothers and sisters, if you study Matthew 13, Jesus equated your heart and my heart to soil. Christ, the seed, he wants to be planted within your heart and in my heart. He wants to germinate. He wants to bud. He wants to sprout. He wants to begin to grow in us, so that we can reflect that image. And that's why the Bible often uses this language. Abide in me and I in you. Is that right? Notice how God, God is in love with the in concept. How do we know? Look at it again. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man be in Christ, he is a what? New creature. Old things are passed away. How about this one? 1 John 3:6, whosoever abideth in him, what happens? Sinneth not. You notice that. All of these blessed experiences when Christ is in us. How about this one? Colossians 1:27. Christ in you, the hope of glory. God wants to be in you. Jesus says, I'm a seed that I want to be planted in your heart. I want to be in you. I want to live out my righteous life within you, through you. Now watch this. I thought of the question, what is the effect of Christ being in us? What is the effect of it? And now here we are, and we're getting to our close. Romans chapter 8 gives us a beautiful statement about this idea of Christ in us. He wants to end the controversy. We're in it, but God has given us a solution on how it will end. And it's found in Romans the 8th chapter. The Bible says in Romans the 8th chapter, it says in Romans the 8th chapter, and when you get there, please say amen. Paul just finished talking about in Romans 7 the things that he wants to do. He finds himself not doing it. The things that he does not want to do, he's doing it. Paul was talking about his condition before conversion. That was not a post-conversion state. That was a pre-conversion state. How do we know? Because of verse 8, chapter 8 and verse 1. What does the Bible say in chapter 8 and verse 1? Tell me if you see it. It says, there is therefore now what? No condemnation, but it only belongs to a certain group. It says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. Now, here's my question. How do you know if you're in Christ Jesus? How would somebody know? Did you know the verse tells you? Look at the verse again. It says, there's therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but do what? Walk after the Spirit. So if I'm in Christ, that means my life should be a life of walking after the Spirit. Does that make sense? What does that mean? What does it mean to walk after the Spirit? That has to make some sense, doesn't it? Verse 3 helps it make sense. It says in verse 3, for what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and for sin, condemn sin in the flesh, watch now carefully, verse 4, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled where? In us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. To walk after the Spirit means it is a lifestyle that is demonstrating the righteousness of God's law. This is the experience that Christ wants to bring us into. Jesus says, I want my mind to become your mind. Jesus says, I want you to commune with me. Jesus says, I want you and I to become one, that we spend so much time together, studying together, choosing together, communing together, that after a period of time, even when God suggests a thought to us, when we follow through, it would be as if we were following our own impulses. Did you know that we can become that one, that much one with Christ? And brothers and sisters, the truth be told, we know many of us, we're not there yet. And as long as we don't get to this experience as a people, the controversy continues. The controversy continues. You see, the Bible tells us that there is going to be a group. They're called patient saints. And that group called the patient saints, the Bible makes a very definite statement about them in Revelation 14, 12. It says, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that are trying to keep. Is that what the verse says? That's not what the text says. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Brothers and sisters, the commandments of God are the very 10 commandments we discussed, God's righteousness. The faith of Jesus is the experience of justification by faith, where God does for us what we could never do for ourselves. Christ in us, the seed. And you know what's so beautiful? You know every seed has to produce a harvest. And the Bible has promised us in Revelation 14, 14 and 15 that a harvest will be produced. There will be a people that are going to reflect the image of Jesus fully. And when they do that, Christ shall come. He will bring them home. He will destroy the wicked, and he will be with them 4,000 years, Revelation 20 tells us. But guess what? When that millennium is over, Jesus comes back, and then that is when a lake of fire shall be produced. And guess who goes in? It is none other than Satan himself. And do you know what the Bible says about Satan at that time? Our last text, Ezekiel 28. The Bible says in the book of Ezekiel, the 28th chapter, it is ever so beautiful, speaking about this being known as Satan. that former covering cherub. The Bible says in the book of Ezekiel, the 28th chapter, and when you get there, please say amen. The Bible says in verses 18 and 19, it says, thou hast defiled thy sanctuaries by the multitude of thine iniquities, by the iniquity of thy traffic. Therefore will I bring forth a fire from the midst of thee. It shall devour thee, and I will bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. All they that know thee among the people shall be astonished at thee. Thou shalt be a terror, and never shalt thou be anymore. You know what those words means? Head crushed. Head crushed. And brothers and sisters, how many of us are willing to be on God's team? How many of us are saying, Lord, we have prolonged the war? Can you imagine we have prolonged the war? Because we, in our hearts and in our homes and in our personal lives, and in many of our churches even, we have allowed sin to come in our hearts. We have allowed it to come in our homes. We have made excuses for it, and we keep thinking that we can't have victory over it when Christ says, you can do all things through me, even have victory. I told you, he says, if I overcame, you can. We have to admit, Father, we have insulted you. We have called you a liar. We have literally believed Satan more than we believed you. The great controversy is between Christ and Satan over mankind's mind, so that Satan says, I want to reflect my image, which is an image of sin. Jesus says, I'm going to reflect my image, which is an image of commandment-keeping righteousness. And Christ wants to do that in your heart and in my heart. You heard my brother talk so much about Sunday and Sabbath, and I thought to myself, I said, you know, Sunday, did you know Sunday represents incompletion? Do you know that Sabbath represents completion? You see, the devil wants to work through that first day of the week because he wants to keep us in an incomplete state. Because the first day of the week was representing an incomplete work. Christ wants to finish a work within us so we can finish his work in this world. And literally, when you look at that first day of the week, it is a symbol of an incomplete work. But when you look at the seventh day Sabbath, brothers and sisters, that is a symbol of a work completed when the only thing left to do is rest. Christ says, I want to finish my work in you. I want to finish my work in you, that my righteousness can be lived out within you, that you can live a life in complete harmony to my law and reflect my image to a dying, sinful world. And we have the privilege of honoring our Savior in doing this. And therefore, my question is very simple. How many of us in this room are willing to say, even through a demonstration of bodily movement by standing to our feet, Lord, I realize I've been holding up the finishing of this war. But by your grace, I choose to be on your team. And I want you to finish your work in me that we can finish your work in this earth. And if you've made that decision, please stand to your feet with me. You're standing to your feet because you recognize it. Lord, I've been holding it back. I've been holding it back. Father, have mercy on me. Forgive me. And he will. As long as you're sincere, he will forgive you, brothers and sisters. He really will. He will forgive you. I'm so grateful that when God one day had to describe himself, he called himself merciful. Merciful, gracious, long-suffering. I'm so thankful that we have such a heavenly Father. And I wonder if there would be someone in this room that says, you know what, I've never, this is, maybe you're standing, but maybe you've never made this declaration before, and maybe this is the first time that you are making this decision to say, I want to be on God's team, I want to honor him, I want the seed of Jesus to come in my heart that I can live and honor him and keep all of his commandments, even including his seventh-day Sabbath. Maybe there's somebody in this room that says, this is my first time for me making this decision. Listen, you don't want to fight this battle and go on this journey by yourself. You're going to need some friends to pray with you, to study with you. And if there's one person in this room that says, you know what, that's me. I'm making a decision. I want to honor God. I want to demonstrate my love to him. I want to be a consistent child of God, and I want to demonstrate it even by honoring him and keeping his law, including his seventh-day Sabbath. Is there one person who says, that's me. This is my first declaration that I make this decision. Bless your heart, my brother. Amen. God bless you, my brother. Amen. Would there be another that says, that's me. That's me. I make a decision that I want to make sure that I'm going to be found as one of God's teammates when he comes. Would there be another who says that's me? I just don't want to pass you by. I can't see very clearly in the back, but if there be someone, I pray the elders or the ushers, you can see that. Hold your hand up. We just want to pray for you. That's all we want to do is we want to pray for you. God bless you, young man. Amen. Would there be another who says that's me? Would there be? I just don't want to miss you. God bless you, sister. Praise the Lord. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, this is a great work that God has called us to do. To tell the brothers and sisters, to let them know there's a place called Babylon. Come out of it. Come into God's truth. Come into God's remnant. And there are decisions like that being made right now. Listen, we're going to pray for you. When we're done, we're just going to ask you to please come up the front. We're going to pray with you. That's what we want to do. We want to pray with you, and we want to do everything possible to strengthen you in the decision you have made for the Lord Jesus Christ today. Let us please reverently bow our heads as we go before the Lord in prayer this time. Loving Father, Father in heaven, we are so thankful that even so late in earth's history, your Spirit is still captivating the hearts of men. And I thank you for every precious soul that has raised their hands, that has made a decision to be part of the team that will cooperate with heaven as you seek to bring an end to this great controversy. Lord, I pray that you will grant them double strength, shower them with your love. Please post double portions of angels around them to keep them. I pray, dear God, that you will remind them that they truly can do all things through Christ who strengthens them. Teach them how to put Jesus first, last, and best in their lives. For the people that do this are the happiest people in the world. And I thank you, Lord, for every person who took their stand today. Father, for all my brothers and my sisters who have made their proclamation, they've made their declaration, but maybe we have slipped along the way and we realize we have frustrated your work. Please forgive us. Please forgive us. Help us to get back on track, to be more focused, and to let not our will, but your will be done. And may we also be found amongst your team that will cooperate with heaven as you seek to finish the war. Thank you, dear God, for speaking to our hearts today and drawing our minds heavenward. In Jesus' name, amen.